You know, on 125th Street in Harlem, there's in the middle of Harlem, there's a record store that's on the south side of the street, on 125th Street, where they played records real loud, you know, and the people passing by. And this West Indian girl had just come to the United States, and she didn't know too many people there, and she was lonesome, and she didn't have a job, you know, so she's walking up 125th Street. And as she's walking up 125th Street, she heard this. She heard this sound, a rhythm from the West Indies, which I had made a record on this, and she stopped. And she felt at home, and then she stopped.
Do you know, when you just did that with your hands, you don't really need an instrument, do you?
Yes.
Yes, you do. It helps.
Yeah.
So people say, and it always sounds funny, they say Dizzy invented bop, as if you woke up one morning and said, what am I going to do today? I think I'll invent bop. It can't happen like that, can it?
By a long shot, no. It's a development, actually. Progressive. Same as a progressive revelation and religion. Progressive revelation. God only gives you so much knowledge of what He's got in store for you at a specific time in your spiritual development. The same as He only lets a guy create so much for a particular era in the development of our music. And we also have messengers and prophets in our music. Yeah. You could call Coleman Hawkins or Lester Young or Charlie Parker
or Louis Armstrong,
a prophet, you know.
Father Hines, right.
Father Hines, too, yeah, because he's a great innovator.
But I must be honest, the first time I heard bop, I suppose it had been in existence in one form or another for about 6 years. It was the early 50s or so. I was frightened by it because I thought the music
was going
the rhythm had been stretched so far it would never snap back to anything I recognized. Mm. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Well, we were always fundamentally correct, even when it sounded out there. I remember one time I was on a program, Stan Kenton was the disc jockey, sort of, you know, and he played Things to Come. And on the ending, when we say, bop, beep, bah, joom, bop, beep, bah, and then we say, bow. Like that, and he reached for that thing. He reached for the turntable before, you know. And he was waiting for it for the last chord to come up, and then finally he took it off.
But so it was difficult for people to adjust.
Yes,
in a way.
I guess.
You see, another thing that I don't understand is the rhythms. It seems to me you select are not they're not blues. They're not Dixie, they're not swing, they are Latin American, Spanish rhythms. How come?
I think there's a very close relationship between the music of the Western Hemisphere that has been created in Brazil, the West Indies, Cuba, and the United States. I think those are the most important ones, you know, and so jazz and calypso and samba and Afro-Cuban, they have the same background. So I expected one day actually to hear a band come out and you don't know where they're from, because they would be playing music of jazz that would be, and they play West Indian, and they play Brazilian. They'll play all in one arrangement. And so they're changing backwards and forwards. So you don't know where they're from. You say, what are they? And you're going to have good soloists because everybody is learning how to play.
Well, then a Martian would say.
One good example is in Cuba. that there's a trumpet player in Cuba that you would not believe. His name is Arturo Sandoval. I just made a record with him. That's why I'm saying this. It will be out soon. Made it in Europe because, you know, United States and Cuba, it's not exactly a love affair. We made this record in Europe, and it's coming out now. And you can hear some of the things that they're doing down there in Cuba. See, stylistically, Cuba has always been rhythm, the drums. And there haven't been too many instrumentalists come out of Cuba to play jazz. But this guy, when I first heard him in Cuba, when we went on that boat down there, I couldn't believe this guy. And so we finally got together, and we made a record together, and it'll be out soon. So we hope that you like it when you see it. And this is the number that we played this now. That's one of the numbers on there.
We go segregated.
So what is it near? It's not near nothing.
Yeah.
And how do you get there? You don't get there. You leave. there's different things like that. Little things. But Chiraw is very nice. They just gave me another day there. I've had a couple of days. And they made me honorary mayor.
Didn't that make you feel a bit bitter? Because it must have been a strictly segregated town when you were growing up.
I had something else, you know. I'm on very good terms with the governor of South Carolina, Governor Riley. He's invited me about four times to spend two or three nights in the executive mansion where I slept in the bed of one of the declarations of independence. That's when we ran y'all out of here. That's what the Declaration of Independence means. The English didn't exactly call it an independence revolution. They call it, they would have called it in the present jargon of this, they would call that a peacekeeping force.
I want to go back to your childhood experience, because I know some of the small towns in the South. Was there a black school and two white schools, or just one black school? Or?
Well, in Chiraw, when I was coming up, there was a white high school, and there was one colored white school. There was a grammar school for whites and grammar school. But now, there's one white school, one junior, junior high school, and several intermediate grades. And then they have some, just today in the paper, in Greenville, South Carolina, there's a college there that has an enrollment of 3,200, and they got eight blacks. And so the President Reagan, I don't like to talk about politics, but this has something to do with me.
It's your life, yeah.
President Reagan went along with tax exempt for this college. Supreme Court just knocked it down. Go ahead, Supreme Court. Paul Robeson was a great. His principles, was unshakable, and they tried everything to shut him up. You know, they gave him film roles, and which he was very capable of doing all this. But they tried everything, man. But they couldn't get to him. He would speak out, man, and he'd look Congress in the eye and say, "Man, I loved it." One time, I can remember one time I was playing at Apollo Theater, and this was the height of McCarthyism that we called it at that time. And the House Un-American Activities Committee, in which they would delve into your personal life and do all these things in American politics. But Robeson came by the theater to see me in the audience, and then left, and then he called me up, and he said, "I just saw the show. It was just gorgeous." And I said, "Well, where were you?" He said, "Well, after the performance, I just left." I said, "Well, why didn't you come backstage and speak to me?" He said, "Well, I didn't want to bring no heat on you."
Nah.
I said, look, Paul, I said, man, you can come to see me anytime. I'll take whatever they give.
Music messages the way religion does. Now, I know you're a religious man. You can't explain everything about Baha'ism, which is the religion you're
connected. It's not.
But I want to know how.
It's not the term Baha'ism. That when you say Baha'ism, you can think of communism, all the other isms. It's not an ism. Being a Baha'i, I guess it's just Baha'i, you know?
But, now I understand one thing that you've said in the book, we won't mention it again, when you say that religion is, the big religions are universal,
mm-hmm.
and they need messengers, and you say music is universal, there is a oneness, you say, about music,
yes,
which
is.
I accept, but why does it need a messenger? If you're a messenger, what message are you bringing us in jazz?
Progressive revelation. Whatever I create, when I have a following, my followings falls in line. And they say, that's the gospel. Or whatever Charlie Parker creates in music, they say, that is the gospel. Whatever Colvin Hawkins, Lester Young, Louis Armstrong, any Miles, Clifford Brown, any of the major establishers of a style.
Well, one of the things that impressed me when the last, well, it was only a couple of nights ago, saw you at Ronnie's, looking at the audience, I would think the oldest was 70s, the youngest just hitting the legal age, just 18 or young.
That's weird.
Many colors. But
well, people sort of like me on the stage because they think that I am real. And I try to be real on the stage as much as possible without being obnoxious because I'm just a natural obnoxious person, as Peter will tell you. but I try not to be, and I try to portray what I represent on the stage, and they go for it.
Well, thank you.